Hi guys. Oh, this is Steve. I'm a trainer working here in Santa Ana, Cagayan Valley to help train net at Cyanide Tropical Fish Collectors to become netsmen. I've been catching nets my whole life, been training nets, training fish collectors my whole life, and we found up here, oh my God, almost everybody using cyanide. And so the mayor banned fish collecting. So, to unban and allow fish collecting, all we have to do is reform the divers and teach them to catch fish with nets. The whole world is using nets. Australia is using nets, and Mexico, and Red Sea. Belize, thanks to Filipinos. Vanuatu, Tonga, Samoa, everywhere. Hawaii, California. Everybody in the world uses nets. Nets, lumbat to catch fish. Only Vietnam, Malaysia, Indonesia, and parts of the Philippines using sodium. Bakit hindi kailangan sodium? Patay coral, it's obvious. Patay coral. Ang coral buhay ng isda. Walang bahay, walang isda. Do we have to repeat that lesson? Walang bahay, walang isda. You kill the coral, you have no fish. Walang bukas, you have no future. Your children will not know coral reef. This already happened in so many places in the Philippines. Already happened. There are reefs in Philippines look like a concrete floor, look like a parking lot. No more coral. Patay lahat. 40 guys using sodium for 10 years, you kill a few million coral heads. Patay millions of coral heads over time. Since 1983, we have had a curriculum of training which explains how to catch fish, decompress fish, not everybody's favorite subject, how to handle fish, you know, diving safety to keep you alive, to keep you healthy. Even if you survive, you don't want to grow old with arthritis. That happens to a lot of divers. So again, how to catch, handle, decompress, and how to keep yourself alive.
You think you can catch so many fish with cyanide? Plenty of divers can catch more than you. Filipinos in Fiji catch more than you. Geez, Filipinos all over the place catch as many or more than you. Even white guys can catch more than you.
But you gotta have the right netting, of course. You have to have that angamit maganda. It has to be invisible. Look, invisible. Underwater, you don't really see it. The fish go right through it, you know? Invisible. And the barrier net, same way. If you have strong current, here in Santa Ana, here in the top end, you have strong current, right? You think we don't have strong current everywhere in the world? Mexico has strong current. There's strong current in Fiji. Oh, you can't even dive half of them. There's strong current in Australia. Everywhere has strong current. That's not the excuse. You can catch fish with the current. But we will show later on, as we get into more specifics, to keep your net up in strong current, you need more floats and more legs. Simple as that. It's as simple as that.
100 days of fish collecting. 50 angelfish would be your average.
Sodium now.
If you're using sodium. This is before and after. How many coral heads are you affecting?
5,000 coral heads.
But die.
But only 50 a day, it's not a lot. Like 50 peso, it's not a lot. But pretty soon, by and by, so many patay. This is one guy.
I'm gonna continue to rhyme here, it's like cyanide rap.
No? Yeah.
One guy can do 50 a day, one guy. Now, what would make this not realistic? If one guy, one good fish collector with sodium, works 100 days, and kills 50 corals a day on the average, he kills 5,000 a year, times how many divers again?
60.
This is why the police are here.
just Santa Ana. This is just this place. I think this community probably thinks it needs to have live coral for food fish, for everybody's income, for the possibility of tourism. There are all kinds of people who have a right to the reef, not just a few people who have decided to destroy it. And this is a single year, one single year. If you make another year and another year, how about 10 years of this? This is why I'm Bak Bilao Kesan, Walang Coral. All the reef in front of the towns look like a parking lot. Everything's dead everywhere. Kilometers you can swim and not find a nice coral head with green chromis in it. You can't find a bicolor. There's no blue tang. Only utan, but no blue tang, you know? And you need more money in the future. You need more fish, more coral. You need better luck. You have more children now. There are more divers now. You're not getting more, you're getting less. A lot less.
The police, if they catch you, maritime police, they will put you in jail. The Bureau of Fisheries, okay, they will stop even supporting this. If you guys don't reform starting today, it's over. It's simple. Okay? We are here to help you, but you have to help us. Stop it. Understand? You can catch with nets. You do not need sodium cyanide. You are the best divers in the world.
The problem is cyanide kills coral. The cyanide attracts the bottle, the cyanide bottle, to the coral head because that's where the fish is running to. So the fish runs to the coral head, and you go after the fish with the cyanide bottle, squirt him in the coral head. The cyanide spreads throughout the coral, throughout the interstices of the coral, the fingers of the coral, underneath it, all around it, and it gets the cyanide cloud envelops the coral. That coral burns. Cyanide disrupts, it depletes oxygen in living cells. And if you deplete oxygen in living cells, whatever that is dying. So it burns out the life of the cells, and the cells die. The effect has a chain reaction, and there's necrosis setting in, and the tissue keeps dying and dying. And you come back 2 days later, and you have a snotty mess all over the coral as it's expelled so much from inside. We're gonna say that one fish is killing one coral, but of course the cyanide plume may go to the next coral and the next. On a nice, healthy, thick reef, it might cover 10 to 15 corals. To catch one coral beauty, or one oriole, or one blue coran, one imperator. If the fish is kind of tough, like some trigger fish, it might take more and more cyanide, which of course, the plume goes further around. Depending on the current, the cyanide might dissipate and dilute quickly. If there's not a lot of current, it gets to hang around and just bleach away and burn everything that it's touching.
If you take away 50% of this, it is still a staggering amount of dead coral. Take it down to 25. Only work, you know, a little bit. The damage is incredible per diver. It's a destruction per unit. Destruction per diver is about as great as any kind of fishery I've ever seen, outside of dynamite fishing.
Ooh!
Dynamite fishers also do this. Dynamite fishers do basically this, you know? Of course, the twin dynamite cyanide thing is famous in the Philippines. It's famous in the Philippines. It's got to stop. You really have to join the 21st century and stop it. It's not a fishery. It's a one-way destruction of everything that you need to make a fishery.
It would be natural to have some fear or apprehensions. How secure do you feel right now before we do this? Anybody worried that it's going to be difficult to do?
For me, it's very real. I got decompression sickness. Decompression sickness means you're almost gonna die. I'm here today, buhay pa rin, eh? Because I didn't die. If I went to the hospital, I would have died. If my diver friends would take me to the doctor, already patay. Patay on the way.
The doctor has no answer for you. He said, there's no solution. The doctor has no answer. I promise you, he has no answer. Only recompression can save your life. I almost died myself. For me, it's very, very real. I know what it means, what's happening to you, and if you don't act quickly, you're gonna die. If you act quickly, you're normal. So, we say that? If you act quickly, you're normal. You don't, you die. I'll tell you why I'm still alive. You can go deep for a certain amount of time and be fine. If you go too deep for too long, now you're breaking the rule and you must pay. So this is how you pay. I went this deep, I caught fish, and caught a, well, we have a rare starfish called a purple lynchia star. Very deep, they're very small. An aquarium fish like it's pretty. So I got about 200 of them, and there were so many I couldn't stop. Picking them up about that fast, into my net. Each one is like a dollar, right? 45 pesos. That's hard to stop. I understand that. Oh my God, that is so understandable.
Right? I mean,
yeah. Every meter there was one more. And so I knew the time was going by. I already know, very tapos ang time. But so much money. Makasarili. I think maybe 35, 40 minutes. You already dive a little bit. You already have something in your blood called nitrogen. Nitrogen in your blood. It's like being drunk.
Oh, para tayong mga lasing na, dizzy na yan.
So 12 fathom, it's not too bad. It's like 4 beers. Maybe 4 San Miguel, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I already have 4 San Miguel. Then come back to the boat. Now, in a short period of time, let's go back down. And at 23 fathom, it's like 8 more San Miguel. So now I'm up to 12 San Miguel beer. If you have 12 San Miguel, how are you? Nitrogen in your blood is like alcohol in your blood. It has pretty much the same effect.
Yeah.
Anyway, so go back to the boat. And I stop under the boat. There's a line. I stop for 10 minutes only. 10 minutes.
10 minutes.
Just hang on the line. That's like decompression a little bit. That's not enough. But I know what you're thinking, we're going to get to it. And then I go back in the boat. I get in the boat. Oh, here's the boat right here. Feeling okay. Gotta have a little bit of drink. No smoking. So many Filipinos smoke in the boat. No smoking in our boat. Okay, about 10 minutes later, in normal, I'm talking to my guy. My guy is Rodolfo. And my tongue got thick, and I can't talk. I can't talk anymore. It's beginning. The decompression is beginning. And so I realize if this continues, 5 minutes, 10 minutes, what else is gonna happen? It's gonna keep growing. Already can't talk, right? Maybe can't breathe. If you can't breathe, you're gonna die in 2 minutes, right? And so, you know, I remember, and the idea is to get to a recompression chamber or get back under the boat. So, went back down, 20 feet, 4 fathoms. So I went back down with the compressor. To 4 fathoms.
4 fathoms.
And instantly, everything disappeared. Inside your lungs, there are a little tiny, it's like other tiny microscopic lungs, called alveoli. Inside your lungs, there are billions of like little sacs, little grapes. And they're in clusters. They all have air that has to go into your bloodstream. If they don't, if they get stuck, you get all these air pockets stuck. And if you can't release it, then they get stuck enough to create the bins. The bins is when you have a traffic jam of air bubbles in a bending area, like your knees, your joints, your elbow. A lot of guys have it on the joints, you know? But man, if it goes in your brain, patay. If it goes in another part, you're paralyzed. Meron solution. You have to go right back down immediately. You have to get back down to 6 fathoms or 7 fathoms and
and dive and get down. You just have to get down and hang on a line.
I won't sleep.
I stayed down. I was afraid. I stayed down 1.5 hours. I never want to go back to the boat. I'm safe. Oh my God, I don't want to go back. I'm afraid to go back. Afraid to go back up. I think that pressure will return. But truthfully, this time below, even 1 hour and 30 minutes, by then, the pressure reduced like an alcoholic. The cure for being drunk is time. Is it not? I mean, it takes a long time, you know? Not so much time in this case. But after 1.5 hours, finish. Go back to the boat and waiting for it this time. And it didn't come back badly. So I can talk to Rodolfo and go, what happened to you? Decompression? Decompress? Almost patay. Yeah, he passed it. So I felt good in the boat, ready to jump back over, but he's so cool. So I know from experience, you can save your life if you go back down. Do not go to the doctor. I tell you, the doctor can't do anything. It's impossible. Because. Yeah, catch up. Why is it impossible to go to the doctor? That's what I want to tell you. Just in time, I got back down, so the pressure on these released. The cluster of little sacs. They're like balloons, right? The pressure decreased the pressure in the balloon. And it gave time for them, for the blood to keep flowing. All the blood kept flowing because no more traffic jam. Traffic jam of little bubbles, little balloons. If you give them time, they go down because your blood will carry away the air, the tiny air bubbles.
Yeah. So you know, if any of you feel sick, immediately back down 6-7 fathoms for 30 minutes to 1 hour. You just stay there, okay?
As long as you want.
As long as you want, you can stay there, okay? 6-7 fathoms.
Okay? There's no damage in 6 fathoms. You've stopped the damage.
No damage.
You stopped it. So you wanna enjoy the stopping it. You want to milk it. You wanna stay stopped.
Right. But this don't make you think you can dive for hours at 140 feet. This is only because of emergency. Don't always make emergency for yourself. Dive smart. Know how many minutes you're down. Don't stay too long. Okay? When you dive deep, you come up slowly in stages. Okay? You still can collect fish in stages. Just don't go deep and then come up. So you dive. They come up, you can collect more fish, and at 6-7 fathoms, stay there. If you want to collect fish, stay there for, you know, 1 hour, 30 minutes, collect fish. And when you come up, you won't ever get sick. You understand? Very, very important. You all know somebody who died. You know somebody who's paralyzed, okay? Now you dive smart because now you know how to protect yourself. We're here to protect you. We worry about you. Fish has no meaning. If you're not okay, why do we need, we must take care of you, okay? We always can get fish, but we can't replace you. You understand me? You can't be replaced. Think, always think, guys, okay? If the fish go deep, let them go. Let them go. Don't follow the fish. Let them go.
Now there are dives with dive tables, which I don't like to show. Because the Navy dive tables say that you don't have as much time as I know you want. You guys break every rule in the Navy dive manual that there is. When you laugh, when I told you I went this deep, and you all go deeper than that, I know that. You all break the rule all the time. 40 fathoms, oh my God, you're dead. 30 fathoms. Can someone tell me what you call a fathom? How long is a fathom? Or what do you
call it? Yung dipa, isang dipa.
Come on.
Ilang feet yan? 6.
Now that's the correct answer. You guys know what 6 feet is? 6 feet, right? 6 feet.
6 feet, I said,
right here.
Times 14. 240 feet.
So 240 feet, you have no time. By the time you get down, it's time to come back. There's no time to work. At 20 fathoms, you're already diving in a dangerous area.
Yeah, so 20 hindi pa palang, medyo delikado na yun.
20 is already dangerous. The more you break the rule without diving, the more you condition yourself to get away with dying. Dying that would kill somebody else. If I dive like you guys dive now, I would die easier than you. If you dive deep so often that your body become more accustomed, conditioned to it, without dying, this is something, you're like a laboratory experiment. This doesn't happen a lot, but it happens with Filipino deep divers. And that is a subject of study and investigation.
Yeah.
You flirt with death every time you do this. You're a living experiment that nobody's paying attention to. I've always seen it. When I went to Pagbilao, Polillo Island, we counted 50 divers who had died. 50 divers who had died. So many single women everywhere, single chicks, because Noah's out. Wow. So it's true, they die. They really do die. But we also know there are many divers who have dove deep, have broken the law all the time, and they didn't die. It's called bone necrosis. Bone necrosis.
Bone necrosis.
Bone necrosis.
Okay. In your tibia, you have two bones here. They're hollow. Right? The normal bone has a strong casing. That's your big, the white, strong part of your bone. Inside, the marrow. You know the one that's masarap up when you eat the chicken? That's called the marrow, okay? Okay, we want to get to this point. Bone and marrow. Bone and marrow. A healthy bone of a no diver, has it like this. Now the marrow is a crisscross of blood vessels and tissue. You know, the marrow looks like this. It's a real, look like netting down there, right? When you dive deep all the time, bubbles?
Bola.
Bola? Bola, yeah. You get a lot of bola in here. And hanging. And when they expand, they break some of this mesh, some of this marrow. The marrow like inside the chicken one, right? That's a kind of a soft stuff, right? How do you explain? Spongy, yeah. But the bubbles bust it up a little bit, day by day by day. If you do something wrong day by day, what happens later on in your life? 10 more years, 15 more years. If this gets too soft and broken, it starts to eat into your bone on the inside. Yeah, okay, like this. Making your bone less thick, less strong, more brittle. When your bones get brittle and weak, they already a bruise or a break, already damaged. So you start to get weaker as an old man and you feel more arthritis, rheumatoid arthritis. You get older faster because you were so macho when you were young. And you have a trade-off. You trade your years later in life for a macho life when you're young. If you break this down too much, you get bone necrosis. They get brittle and you get arthritis. And arthritis is not fun. If you're crazy and you want to die young and handsome, keep diving at 25 to 30 fathoms. Okay, but if you can go one dive deep a day and then one medium, like in a, maybe you're near a reef, the second one, you only dive to maybe 15 fathoms. Only one deep a day. Every day you go deep, but only one time. But then you do a medium dive, and that's your day instead of two deep ones.
Right. 2D point is much, much more dangerous than 1.5. It was a training I didn't approve of, but they have professional Filipino dive teacher come and do it. Professional Filipino from Manila. He did it exactly correct. Nobody understood him, but he did it very correct technically. He gave them these strict Navy dive tables, the strict rules, and basically told them, none of you guys are ever gonna work again because we're not gonna let you if you go by exactly what I say. The dive tables are strict. They're not meant for these guys at all. They're meant for tourists. They're meant for other things. The dive tables are shocking to you, not to other people. And I will show you why. The Navy dive tables and the ones that all recreation sport divers go by, all the sport divers that come to Tubataha and go see the beautiful reefs of the Philippines, these guys are generally certified, trained scuba divers, right? And this is what they learn. This is what they learn in scuba. At 100 feet back, so I can talk smoother. If you can translate it into fathoms, I understand the problem. 100 feet is, you see, it stops my thought process. 15, 16, 17 fathoms, I think. The dive tables are made in feet. They say at 100 feet, how many fathoms? 16 fathoms?
16 fathoms.
You have 20 minutes. We have no decompression. You get down, you work for 20 minutes, and you get out of there. 20 minutes. None of you are gonna do that, right? Who's gonna work for 20 minutes and call it a day?
Who's gonna work for 20 minutes? Nobody.
According to the Navy decompression tables, 50 feet or 8 fathoms, you can dive 100 minutes, almost 2 hours, without paying by having to decompress. Now, at 80 feet, which is like 12 fathoms, 14 fathoms, you're only allowed 40 minutes. They give you minutes for the depth.
So at 15 fathoms, 40 minutes.
40 minutes.
Without decompression.
Without decompression. So 20 fathoms, wow. They don't give you much time. Now, if you make 130 feet, 150 feet, 25 fathoms, 30 fathoms, 35 fathoms, 35 fathoms. Go down, work 1 minute, come back. That's what they will tell you.
That's what they would tell you if this was the Navy dive chart.
Now, the solution, and that's something we should take seriously here now, is decompression stops under the boat. Have any of you ever done that? Stop under the boat and hang out under the boat. Hang on the decompression line. Of course you have to have a decompression line for the fish and for you. So the line already under the boat waiting for you to come up. When you come up from the bottom, you have to have a line so you can hang off your fish, your baldes, and hang off yourself. The fish have to decompress just like you. You both have to be decompressed. Decompression is buhay. If you don't like the subject matter, you can't really be a diver. You can't be a good one. Decompression is very important for you and the diver. You both need to do it. Yeah. When a fish is at rest and having no problem at all, his air bladder, this is the air bladder, look at this, is relaxed and payat. Malinquinita. Very safe. Right? There's the umbrella. And it fits in the stomach and the heart, the liver. Everything fit inside, huh? The air bladder is flat. It's flat. He never has a problem in his life with the air bladder. Never. Air bladder is normal. All he has to do is a little bit inflate, a little bit down, but the air bladder basically stays the same, giving him a balance. That's why fish don't sink. If he stops swimming, he doesn't sink. He stays floating with a little bit of air. This is a long air bladder. Now when you take him, you catch him and take him up, this never happened before. In millions of years, this doesn't happen. It only happens when these guys show up. So, his air bladder starts to expand.
you take from this diagram, your isda, okay, your typical isda, what kind of isda is that? It's a very happy. Very happy. Not the blue line. Okay, as you remember the diagram, the air bladder fits nicely inside the fish, right? Making equilibrium, you know? The fish is always straight on. He doesn't lose his balance. He's perfectly balanced. This is perfectly sided. It's a wonder of nature, the air bladder. But when people come in and we catch him and we take him up, he has a liver here, a heart, spleen, all the intestines, the ano. This is where the ano is. You know about the ano? Okay. Now, when you take him up, the air bladder expands. Now the air bladder is too full, blowing up. Where does the heart and the stomach and the ano and the spleen, where does it go? Pushed. It's pushed. It's pushed in a way it's never been pushed before. It's pushed with a pressure it doesn't know. It's the same as if you have a basketball and you put it in Raymond's stomach. Boom! Where did your heart go? Up here. You can't make your heart go up here. It's not made for that pulling. Your spleen, your liver, it's not made to go all over, displaced by the basketball, right? Suddenly, not slowly like in pregnancy. In pregnancy, it takes a long time for the stomach of the woman to get big, right? So there's a slow accommodation. Even still, it's not pleasant, right? I hear it's not pleasant. But there's a slow accommodation for the baby to slowly push. But if she was suddenly 9 months pregnant, in a second, oh my God, that would be a disaster, that would be a catastrophe. That would be horrible, like, yeah, she would be dueling and die, right? So it takes a long time, but in this case, it's instant. You take it up, the air bladder blows up, and all of the organs go to the side, right? One of the first things you see, he starts to poop a lot, right? Because the air is just pushing. And he also makes the fish poop before it's supposed to. It's a myth. If you ask a lot of people, how do you decompress the fish? They would say, you start to pull in the bucket slowly. Have you ever heard that one?
Yung iba ang ginagawa pagka nilidompress, nasa pagka dahan-dahan na lang inihina. Yan ang ginagawa ng iba, di ba?
I've handled thousands of fish. I never pull up the bucket slowly. You can pull it up as fast as you want, halfway. Better over here. This, okay, we're 20 fathoms, huh? Halfway to 10, immediately. Here's the surface. 10 fathoms immediately. From 20 to 10 has no damage. Then the air bladder can hold this much. The first 50% is only this much, actually. We're not filling it. If you bring it up instantly, you haven't filled it to the danger point. You're getting there. But you can automatically do it. Better question. Two San Miguel, you can pound them in a minute. The next two, it's getting a little harder because you got a pull, right? So you're already gonna get the two down easy. So you get the first 50% of the water column for free. The first 50% of the water column, you can bring the fish up right away. You've minimized your problem now to this amount to decompress. You don't have to worry about this part.
Great.
Get it here.
hang them up. What I would do in Mexico, and I know we're not in Mexico, but we have areas where we would simply tie these off with a lead weight and a jug float, leave them overnight, and relax. Tomorrow morning, these things are so perfectly decompressed, we bring them up another 50% for, say, an hour, and then we can go. You know, when you die, you got a halo, right? We want to avoid the halo effect. We don't want anything to die. So if you remember the halo, this is how you keep your fish straight. We want to avoid heat. Heat, marinating your fish in heat is terrible. They've got to be protected. Ammonia, the caca from the fish, with high heat, it's a recipe for disaster. Low oxygen occurs when you have a lot of heat and too many fish in the bucket. That ruins them. And you need effective decompression to avoid the fish becoming haloed. If they're haloed, they suck and nobody wants them. They're not worth nothing. And if you get them past him, you've ripped him off. If you get them to Manila, they are so strict on the rejection, that's how they protect themselves. Why would you go back to cyanide after this training? You won't. We're sure you won't. You won't have a buyer. You're going to be playing cat and mouse with BFAR, and if you get caught, I wouldn't want to get caught in a lot of countries using cyanide. And it looks like this country is going to join them. Look, Matt, there is a CDT, a cyanide detection test. There is a cyanide detection test. There's also been many cyanide detection tests. Some of them controversial and not conclusive. But one is in use right now. In Palawan, they use a cyanide detection test in Puerto Princesa.
Yes.
They take samples. They already do it. They already do it. So this is my sodium, this one right here. This is the Mercedes poker, the best poker in the world. This poker will last 1,000 years, but it won't because somebody will steal it before 1,000 years easily. So when fish go into a hole or a crevice, there's no fish in the world that wants this up their butt, that's for sure. And so we basically convince him to leave into the waiting barrier net. The barrier net is set up around the coral. You can see the coral heads here. They have fish. We drop the net in a half moon, like a corral for horses. And then you drop back here, and you just corral the fish towards the net. You get them into the net, they go into this coral perhaps. You loose them out, loose them out, loose them out, under there, under there, under there. This can be flexible, you can change it if you want. And they run one by one into the net. Into the net. When they run into this kind of net that we're gonna make today, they run and they get stuck momentarily. They run into this one and they get stuck. You just come up behind them gently with the hand net and collect them as you go. Sometimes 15 or 20 fish will run and you catch 10 to 15 of those fish. Sodium cannot do that. Sodium gets them one by one or two by two, but it doesn't get a school. We get a school of fish. Don't kill any coral. Don't kill any babies. Don't kill any simia. No eggs, no crustacean, no sponges, no shrimp. Nothing is killed. Nothing is killed. Only the fish you want. You take the 2, 3, 4 fish and you're done. Look. Australian guys often do it like this. Put a rock in the net. Lay a rock inside. So now the net is laid down. Here's the reef, huh? Lay down more. So much net on the bottom. When the fish go in, net, net, wherever he goes, there's net. They often run to the rock also. But the net, the long net is just a corral. A corral to hold the fish against the wall as you come up and catch it with your little scoop net. And then you use the scoop net to take him off the wall. This is the only way you're allowed to catch fish in many countries. If you don't like it, you're not gonna work. So this is it. You don't have a choice.
It's not sodium or net. It's net. There's no choice. You cover this side with your body. Close up a little bit. I want to tighter you. I don't want him to have any chance. He's only got one way to go. And that would be, you pull like that. One, two. At this point, he's probably just going to run. Boom, right into there. Or run into there. And he will be surprised. Oh my God, what did I just hit, right? Because it's invisible underwater.
Kasi itong net na to, invisible pag nasa tubig, hindi nila makikita.
So with your scoop net.
Okay, your scoop net, muli ang isda.
You can do this slowly, easily, calmly.
Kahit dahan-dahan, mamuli yung isda.
Go, go. Got it. Now, this is the only way we catch fish in most of the world.
Oh, ito lang yung only paraan para mahuli isda. Net and poker.
The only way. Because none of us want to go to jail, and in most of the world, that's where you're born, is in the cyanide. You'll get better and better with this.
What will be the effects of this training to the world market?
This might be the shot heard around the world. I hope so. We've had a 20-some year layoff, and now we begin again. This is perhaps our last chance to get it right. On one hand, the rules come into effect and people are going to start going to jail like never before. But they don't have to go to jail. They can be trained. We have to support our own reform, not only the exporters, but the importers who depend on the exporters to send them fish. The market and the consumer also has been very lax in insisting that this thing be done sustainable. We've let this trade slide because everybody just want to make money off of cheap fish. Those days are going to end. We're not even going to have fish if we don't do it right. So the consumer, the retailer, the importers, they have to get behind a concrete, positive, working, proven solution. We just proved it this week. And excuse me if we're not like a little happy about it. And we can do this again and again and again. We can train every cyanide fisherman in this country. And they can catch every fish in this country with nets. You don't need cyanide to do it. We're better with nets. We catch more with nets. But it's true, if you don't have net collecting experience, cyanide seems to be a better, more effective way. But if you have training in nets, you catch more, and you catch it in perpetuity. You catch it in a sustainable way, not just a one-shot deal and then move on. So yeah, the whole trade is responsible for this. It's an international trade, and the international community has not given very much. This training had to happen in a private way. We have just finished training another 30 guys, mostly cyanide fishermen, to use nets. Without Barnett, without RBS, there's no way this would happen. I don't know how long it would ever take to get aquarium reform started at the field level again. Many aquarium people are willing to start reform on Facebook, on chat, on blog, and on the internet, but not in the field. The field is the only place it counts. If you aren't clean from the field, you're not clean anywhere. So RVS has decided to put its money where its mouth is and to support field stations that have to obey company policy, that have policies and procedures that are clean and legal. That means catching fish with nets. Company policy means that you decompress the fish. You have to handle the fish according to the way the company wants the fish handled.